I remember being in Japan and seeing an elderly lady approach a telephone pole that had a shrine put onto it. It was a wooden structure that had statuettes inside of it. And I remember I was a student over there. I was a young Christian at the time, but I remember seeing this lady bow her head and quietly clap her hands in front of it and issue her prayer to that statue. And I thought to myself that statue has no power to answer her prayers. That statue had no power to answer her prayers. They were falling on deaf ears. And it struck me how horrible it is in this life to not have a God who can hear or can answer and can help. But even more so is that God will be of absolutely no help to her in the world to come, in eternity, for it's just a statue. And I thought, how could somebody worship a statue and think, well, that's a God? And then I remembered, before I came to faith in Christ, there were lots of things, not necessarily statues, but lots of other things that I worshiped in place of a God. Money, security, prestige, the approval of others, pleasure. You know, every person worships some God. Even those that would describe themselves as atheists or agnostics worship something by their actions. You know, we as believers, of course, in Jesus Christ, we recognize that we follow a God, the true and living God of the Bible. Those that follow Islam or Hinduism or Judaism or Buddhism, they would follow some higher power depending on what they would name it, or many gods in the case of Hinduism. But even those that claim no specific God, they look to something like we look to a God. You know, we're hardwired to believe in the Lord. And when we look to something for life or safety or help or joy or meaning or value, even if it's something material on this earth, we're slotting it into that place in our life where only God belongs. And so we need to be safe, so we look to money and we go after money and we save money and everything's about money. Money has become a God if we do that. It's the same thing with pleasure. We want joy, and so we seek after pleasure. We seek after material possessions, and we dive wholeheartedly after them. And when they don't fulfill, we think we need a newer, bigger, more expensive, or greater pleasurable experience. Or maybe we look to what other people think of us for value instead of finding it elsewhere, whether it's in the virtual world with the followers and the likes and the subscribers, or whether we find that in the real life. These are unsatisfying substitutes, and like a statue, an idol, they have no real power to aid us in the end. And so how do we end up here, and why is it so easy to worship something other than God as a God? Well, the children of Israel, as we continue our sermon series on the wanderings in the wilderness, they show us a very important lesson on how easy it is to worship something in the place of God. After being shown undeniable proof of God's power on Mount Sinai, they quickly abandon him for something so much less. Let's join them together in Exodus chapter 32 and verse 1, and let's watch and learn what we can from the scriptures this morning. And when the people saw that Moses delayed to come down out of the mount, the people gathered themselves together unto Aaron and said unto them, Up, make us gods which shall go before us. For as for this Moses, the man that brought us up out of the land of Egypt, we wot not what has become of him. Verse 2 of Exodus 32. And Aaron said unto them, Break off the golden earrings which are in the ears of your wives, of your sons, and of your daughters, and bring them unto me. And all the people brake off the golden earrings which were in their ears, and brought them unto Aaron. And he received them at their hand, and fashioned it with a graving tool, after he had made it a molten calf. And they said, These be thy gods, O Israel, which brought thee up out of the land of Egypt. And when Aaron saw it, he built an altar before it. And Aaron made a proclamation and said, Tomorrow is a feast to the Lord. And they rose up early on the morrow and offered burnt offerings and brought peace offerings. And the people sat down to eat and to drink and rose up to play. And the Lord said unto Moses, Go, get thee down. For thy people, which thou broughtest out of the land of Egypt, have corrupted themselves. They have turned aside quickly out of the way which I commanded them. They have made them a molten calf, and have worshipped it, and have sacrificed thereunto, and said, These be thy gods, O Israel, which have brought thee up out of the land of Egypt. And the Lord said unto Moses, I have seen this people, and behold, it is a stiff-necked people. Now therefore, let me alone, that my wrath may wax hot against them, and that I may consume them, and I will make of thee a great nation. Let's pray together. Father, take this passage and open it. Give us understanding, not just facts, but truth, as you guide us into truth by your Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. The children of Israel were slaves in Egypt, and God brought them out of Egypt by a mighty hand on their way towards the promised land, the land of Canaan, a land of abundance. But in between Egypt and the promised land was the desert, was the wilderness that they had to pass through. And the lessons that they learned during their wilderness wanderings was to teach them to have faith in God, to trust God for the things that they could not do for themselves, to trust God that no matter how hard a situation was, he would come through every time. And they find themselves having just encountered God at the Mount of God, Mount Sinai. God came down, if you recall, with thunderings and lightnings, and they could not doubt for a moment that it was the Lord, the power that he displayed. In fact, they were terrified, and they said, Moses, you go speak to God on our behalf. We don't want to get too close to him. Because if they had wandered in and they hadn't purified themselves, it said that they touched the mount, they would die. And so they stayed and camped down there, and God called Moses away, and Moses was gone for a long time. In Exodus chapter 24, if you'd look back there, in Exodus 24, in verse number 12, we read about why Moses is missing. In Exodus 24, in verse number 12, and the Lord said unto Moses, come up to me and unto the mount, and be there, and I will give thee tables of stone and a law and commandments which I have written, that thou mayest teach them. So God is going to give Moses the law. He's going to give him the commandments. Verse number 18 of Exodus 24. And Moses went into the midst of the cloud and gat him up into the mount, and Moses was in the mount 40 days and 40 nights. So for 40 days and 40 nights, Moses is missing. He left Aaron and Hur in charge of the people, and he told the people, if you need anything, you go to them and you speak to them. Moses is gone 40 days, and the people are just sitting there camping. Now, all of their needs have been met, right? God has shown how he was going to provide for them through the manna, that he was going to meet their needs. They'd have water in the wilderness. They weren't hurting for anything, but they had a lot of time to sit there. And eventually, they got sick of waiting for Moses. They got sick of waiting on God. And so they demanded Aaron to make them gods, something that they could see, something that they could touch, something that they could put their arm around. You know, it's really hard to believe in things that you cannot see. It's hard to believe in things that you can't see. It's a lot easier to have something right in front of you. And that's what they wanted. Back in Exodus 32, they go up to Aaron in verse 1. And the people saw that Moses delayed to come down out of the mount. The people gathered themselves together unto Aaron and said unto him, up, make us gods which shall go before us. For as for this Moses, the man that brought us up out of the land of Egypt, we wot not what has become of him. We don't even know where Moses is. We don't know what he's up to. It's been several days, 40 days, 40 nights. We don't know. I mean, a man wanders off into the desert for 40 days or 40 nights. Maybe he's dead. We don't know what's going on, but we don't have him, and we used to have him, so we need a god or something. You see, they had lived in Egypt for hundreds of years, generations, where they were used to having statues of the Egyptian gods. And even the people in the land that they were in now, the Amalekites, they had their own statues. And it was a common thing for somebody to have a statue and to worship the god that it represented. And they were going to find out from the law, if they could have waited for it, that God said, don't make yourself any graven images of me. I am not like anything on this earth, and you're not to do that. That would become idolatry. It would become putting something in the place of God. But they didn't want to hear that. They needed something that they could get their heads and their hands around. God was too big, too scary. And they said, we want a God. You make us something. You make us something. And Aaron, can you believe it? Aaron says, okay. Verse number 2. And Aaron said unto them, break off the golden earrings which are in the ears of your wives, of your sons, and of your daughters, and bring them unto me. So he takes up a collection of gold. Verse 3. And all the people break off the golden earrings which were in their ears and brought them unto Aaron. And he received them at their hand and fashioned it with a graving tool after that he had made it a molten calf. And they said, these be thy gods, O Israel, which brought thee up out of the land of Egypt. So The God who turned the Nile River into blood, who brought the lice and the frogs, who brought the flies, who killed off all their cattle with the murrain in Egypt, who brought down fire to burn up their crops, who brought darkness for 3 days' time, that God who parted the Red Sea and brought them through on dry land, crushing their enemies behind them as the water came back, that God who provided water in the wilderness and manna for them to eat in the wilderness, that God is a cow. Anybody else disappointed? This is really what they thought their God was going to look like. In fact, when they saw it, they said, these are the gods that brought us up out of Egypt. These are the gods that brought us up out of Egypt. See, what they did was they didn't create a brand new God. They took who God was and they went off course. In a moment, God's going to use the word, they've corrupted themselves. Meaning they took what was pure and right and they went off course and they fashioned a God in their own image. Something that was more comfortable for them. This unknowable God, this God of majesty and power who made the lightnings and the thunders and the fire on the mount, the God that we can't even approach, who's terrifying, we don't like him. We know how to deal with cows. We know what to expect from cows. And this is a golden cow, so it's not just any cow. It's a really good one. And this is what we're going. And Aaron saw the direction that the crowd was going, and he jumped out in front of it. And he's like, let's build an altar and start worshiping it. He saw them declare, these are your gods. And he built an altar, it says in verse 5, and when Aaron saw it, he built an altar before it. And Aaron made proclamation and said, tomorrow is a feast unto the Lord. To the Lord. We're going to have a holiday. We're going to have a holy feast. We're going to have a festival unto the Lord tomorrow. And this is the Lord now, this calf. In verse 6, they rose up early on the morrow and offered burnt offerings and brought peace offerings. And the people sat down to eat and to drink and rose up to play. So that which should only have been given to God, they started to give to something other than God. The place in their lives that should have only been given to God, they have now given to something so far less. Verse number 7. The scene switches and we find that God and Moses are talking on the mount. And the Lord said unto Moses, go, get thee down, for thy people, which thou broughtest out of the land of Egypt, have corrupted themselves. Verse 8, they've turned aside quickly out of the way. How quick is that, isn't it? Isn't it striking how quick it is? I mean, 40 days ago, they beheld miraculous power. They entered into a covenant with God, and they said, we will be your covenant people. They made that solemn mutual agreement with one another, saying, hey, we're yours. We're going to do whatever you say. 40 days later, they're dancing around, as we'll see in a moment, naked before a golden calf, worshiping it. And you want to say, how could you do that? How could you go from seeing God's miraculous power and his provision in your life, and 40 days later, you've abandoned him or so corrupted your idea of him that now you're committing all of this sin? How could you do that? You want to say, boy, aren't they a mess? But we got to be honest with ourselves how quickly we turn away from the Lord when we're tired of waiting on him. How quickly we turn away from the Lord when he doesn't give us what we want, how we want it. And we would say, no, we don't do that. This world is very guilty of taking the idea of who God is and changing him to be a little more tame, a little more controllable, a little bit more like us. You see, the Greek gods, the Roman gods, even the Egyptian gods, they had, I mean, it was like a soap opera. How many of you have read some of the myths? Right? They're like a raunchy soap opera. That's what they are. And they took the gods and they made them like themselves, but more powerful, someone that they could understand, and they explained away a lot of things. God Almighty is too much for them. They don't like that. And our culture has done the same thing. God is no longer the holy, just one. He is now an old man in a rocking chair on a celestial porch somewhere drinking some sweet tea. Just kind of sitting there. He's harmless. You can pray to him every once in a while if you want to. Come and visit him. Come and visit grandpa every once in a while. He has some wisdom. It doesn't really apply for today, but, you know, just come and say hi to him. Or he's like Santa Claus for adults, and even if you do bad, you're not really going to end up getting coal, because no one ends up getting coal, right? No one does that. That's what they've taken who God is, and they've made him a whole lot more comfortable. He's not a God of judgment. He's not a God of wrath against sin. He's not a God who would take a stand against something that maybe we would not want. We've changed his image, and they changed his image. How quickly they turned away, verse 8, and have made themselves a molten calf and have worshipped it and have sacrificed thereunto and said, these be thy gods, O Israel, which brought thee up out of the land of Egypt. If it wasn't God saying it, I could almost imagine Moses saying, no, they wouldn't go so far as to make a molten calf and start worshiping it. I mean, that's ridiculous after everything we've been... Oh, you're being serious. I better get down there, right? You could almost, if it wasn't God, you could imagine that he might be racked with disbelief. But they had to fashion something that they felt comfortable worshiping. In verse 9, and the Lord said unto Moses, I have seen this people, and behold, it is a stiff-necked people. You've met somebody stiff-necked, haven't you? They won't turn for anything. They're unteachable. They won't listen. They're the smartest person whenever they walk into the room. They have nothing to gain from anything you have to say. And when you talk to them, they're just waiting for their chance to speak back. They're not actually listening. May God keep us all humble and teachable, right? That's one of my great desires, because as soon as you stop learning and growing, you start dying and shriveling up. And they, he said, they're stiff-necked people. Is that the truth? It is, because God said it. And we see they didn't want to turn. They didn't want to change. They had gotten all of this bad baggage with them from being in Egypt for all of those years. And now they turn back. And God says, now therefore, let me alone that my wrath may wax hot against them and that I may consume them and I will make of thee a great nation. Here's my offer, Moses. Here's my offer. Let's just destroy them. Let's just destroy all this people. They perverted themselves. They've corrupted themselves. Let's destroy them, and I'll take you, and we'll start over. We'll start over with your family. Same promise I made to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, I'm going to make to you, and we'll just start over with your family. He said, if you give me leave to do that, if you let me alone to do that, that's what'll happen. We'll just start over with them. And you'd say to yourself, isn't that a bit extreme? Isn't that a bit extreme that God would consider destroying these hundreds of thousands of people, if not over a million people, and starting over with Moses because they've committed idolatry? You'd say, that seems a little bit overboard. All they did was, you know, make a golden calf. It's not that big of a deal. Here's why it's that big of a deal. As soon as you change the image of God, as soon as you abandon who God is, you remove the basis for all morality. Right and wrong are gone. Because all you're left with is opinion. If you don't have something bigger than us, it's just our society versus another society, or our belief structure versus another belief structure is what's to right or wrong. If there's no grown-up, so to speak, out there telling us what's right and wrong, the kids get to make up for themselves what the rules of the game are. And a society is cast into depravity as soon as there's no longer right and wrong. And when you take God out of it, that's what you end up with. And so by removing God from society, you are dooming a society to wickedness. And that's what the law was going to come down and say, listen, you're undermining the whole basis of good and evil, right and wrong, true and false, by substituting something else for God. Moses jumps in the way and begs for God's mercy. Verse 11, and Moses besought the Lord his God and said, Lord, why doth thy wrath wax hot against thy people, which thou hast brought forth out of the land of Egypt with great power and with a mighty hand? Wherefore should the Egyptians speak and say, for mischief did he bring them out, to slay them in the mountains and to consume them from the face of the earth? Turn from thy fierce wrath and repent of this evil against thy people. He says, don't do it. He said, your enemies are going to speak evil of you. They're going to say you couldn't do it, or you did it on purpose. You brought this people out. Moses is saying your glory is going to be tarnished if you don't bring your people through it. He said, why have you gotten so angry? He said, turn from your fierce wrath and repent of this evil against thy people. Verse 13, remember Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, thy servants to whom thou swearest by thine own self, and saidst unto them, I will multiply your seed as the stars of heaven. And all this land that I have spoken of will I give unto your seed, and they shall inherit it forever. And the Lord repented of the evil which he thought to do unto his people. God heard Moses' prayer, and Moses had begged as an intercessor. He jumped in between God's wrath against sin and the sinners upon whom judgment was coming. They didn't even know it. They were sitting down there in their unclothed revelry, eating and drinking and dancing about this. They didn't even understand how close to destruction they were. And Moses jumped in the way and he said, no, don't do it. Don't do it. For your own glory's sake, for your name's sake, because of the promise that you've made, don't do it. And God hears, and he says that he will show mercy and not consume them entirely. Verse 15, Moses turned and went down from the mount, and the two tables of the testimony were in his hand. The tables were written on both their sides. On the one side and on the other were they written, and the tables were the work of God. And the writing was the writing of God graven upon the tables. What a day. Moses coming down out of the mount, having been given the law, having met with God for 40 days, he's bringing down the very fashioned handiwork of God. This should have been a great day of rejoicing, of God's people worshiping the Lord. And what does he find? He finds such a mess that Joshua, who's with him in the mount, he hears something, and he thinks that the children of Israel are under attack. He thinks that they're under attack. Verse 17, and when Joshua heard the noise of the people as they shouted, he said unto Moses, there is a noise of war in the camp. They're making their way down the mount. They haven't been able to see the people yet, but they hear them. Verse 18, and he said, it is not, Moses speaking here, it is not the voice of them that shout for mastery, neither is it the voice of them that cry for being overcome, but the noise of them that sing do I hear. He says, this is what, I don't hear the sound of them winning, and I don't hear the sound of them crying out for mercy and losing. I hear people throwing a party. I hear people singing. I hear people celebrating. This isn't the noise of war. Verse 19, and it came to pass, as soon as he came nigh unto the camp, that he saw the calf and the dancing, and Moses' anger waxed hot, and he cast the tables out of his hand and brake them beneath the mount. Just so you know, Moses had a temper. He really did. He really did. We see it a number of places. He gets angry at somebody for beating a Hebrew slave, and he murders that Egyptian slave driver, buries him in the desert. Right? He gets angry later on in the desert when God tells him to do something. Out of his anger against the people, he doesn't obey the Lord the right way, and he loses out on his opportunity to go to the promised land with them. He has a temper, and we can see that, and he casts these down. What a great symbol of how the children of Israel have already broken the laws and the covenant that God had made with them. Well, what happens to these people? What does Moses do? It says in verse 20, and he took the calf which they had made and burnt it in the fire and ground it to powder and strawed it upon the water and made the children of Israel drink of it. Yeah, so Moses comes down in his anger. They bust this thing down. They burn it. They grind it into powder. And he straws it upon the water, probably some stream running down off Sinai, and he casts what's left of it, and he makes all of them drink. You want your God? Here you go. Drink up. Drink up. Then he moves to Aaron. Verse 21. And Moses said unto Aaron, what did this people unto thee, that thou hast brought so great a sin upon them? Aaron was left in charge. And we can see a little bit of what was going on in Aaron's heart, because he was willing to do this thing that he knew he ought not to have done, and he got out ahead of it because he liked the leadership of it, and maybe Moses isn't coming back down from the mountain, and maybe it's time for Aaron to shine here instead of Moses. What did you do? Did they threaten you? Did they threaten to go back to Egypt? What did they do to you? Verse 22, Aaron's great excuse here. Let not the anger of my Lord wax hot. Thou knowest the people that they're set on mischief. For they said unto me, make us gods, which shall go before us. And as for this Moses, the man that brought us up out of the land of Egypt, we want not what has become of him. I mean, you weren't here. You know, if you had been here, it would have been different. It's a little bit your fault. It's not really my fault. You know the people. You know the people. They're the people. They're set on mischief. They're going to cause trouble. They're going to cause trouble. And I said unto them, whosoever hath any gold, let them break it off. So they gave it me, and then I cast it in the fire, and there came out this calf. I threw it in there, and there it is. It's just poof. Now, if you look back at the beginning of this, it says that he, with a graving tool, made it. But he's like, it just happened. I don't know how it got here. It's like your kid's covered in chocolate, and they're like, I don't know who ate it. Right? It's like, I don't know who broke that, and they're sitting among the broken pieces of it. It's that ridiculous. And he tries to cast away the blame. Just so you know, during all of this, God wanted to kill Aaron. But only because Moses jumped in between on Aaron's behalf did Aaron survive. Look in Deuteronomy 9. In Deuteronomy 9 in verse 20, listen to this. And the Lord was very angry with Aaron to have destroyed him. And I prayed for Aaron also the same time. God wanted to kill off Aaron. We'll find a different high priest. We'll go a different route. He said, let's put it, and Moses jumped in the way and he said, no, don't do that. Don't do that. And God listened. Verse 25, and when Moses saw that the people were naked, for Aaron had made them naked unto their shame among their enemies. Then, verse 26, Moses stood in the gate of the camp and said, who is on the Lord's side? Let him come unto me. And all the sons of Levi gathered themselves together unto him. They had devolved quickly. Things had fallen apart quickly. And here they were, naked, dancing around, worshiping some false idol, drinking, eating, feasting, indulging themselves. And he said, who's on the Lord's side? That's what Moses' call went out for. Not this thing, not Aaron. Who's on the Lord's side? And praise God, there were people that stood up and said, we will be counted with the Lord. We did not bow ourselves down to this idol. And all the sons of Levi gathered themselves together. And he, meaning Moses, in verse 27, said unto them, thus saith the Lord God of Israel, put every man his sword by his side, and go in and out of out from gate to gate throughout the camp, and slay every man his brother, and every man his companion, and every man his neighbor. And the children of Levi did according to the word of the Lord, and there fell of the people that day about 3,000 men. 3,000 people died because they couldn't wait on God. 3,000 people died because they weren't satisfied with the situation God had put them in. Because Aaron wouldn't stand up and say no against the people, 3,000 people died. Because Aaron saw an opportunity to advance himself instead of condemning it, 3,000 people died. For Moses had said, consecrate yourselves today to the Lord, even every man upon his son and upon his brother, that he may bestow upon you a blessing this day. And there was a blessing that was supposed to come when Moses arrived with the tables, the tablets of stone, and they were supposed to consecrate themselves, meaning make yourselves pure and clean and ready, and they missed out on the blessing that God was going to give him. There's some powerful lessons that you and I get from God's word today. The first one is that everybody wants a God. Everyone wants a God. Idolatry is when we look to something other than God himself to be our God. You see, we're hardwired to be dependent, and we'll settle for anything that seems to fit the need, though. We're hardwired to be dependent on God, but we'll settle for anything that fits the need. You want peace? You want peace, but you don't want it from God. So you'll settle for the numbness of alcohol, drugs, scrolling, binge-watching, whatever it might be, we'll numb ourselves with it. You want security, but we'll settle for money. There's things money can't buy and can't do, but it can do a lot, and it's a whole lot easier than believing God, so we'll let money become our God. You want joy and fulfillment? Well, we'll settle for pleasure and sex and possessions. You want meaning? You'll jump on the bandwagon of whatever societal virtuous crusade is going on at the moment and change our profile picture like we just changed the world. You want value? Well, instead of getting it from God, let's just settle for what others think of me and their approval. Everybody wants a God. Even people that don't believe in gods worship something and want something and look to something more than themselves. That's why they're always going after something else and deeper. They keep plugging things into that God-shaped hole in their life, and nothing fits other than the true and living God. And so they're always dissatisfied. Everyone wants a God. The second thing is many don't want to wait on the Lord. Many don't want to wait on the Lord. The children of Israel were tired. They were done waiting for Moses. So they moved on to something else. God does not work on my personal schedule. Anybody notice that God doesn't work on your personal schedule? And he doesn't take my laundry list of prayers exactly as I tell him how to do stuff, right? I give him a list often. Why doesn't he just do it my way, right? The old adage says, if I had God's power, I'd change a bunch of things. But if I had God's power and God's wisdom, I'd change nothing, because then I would know better. It doesn't move on our timetable. And when we don't see it moving on our timetable, we begin to doubt him and we move on to something else. So if we get tired of waiting or we don't like the result we get, we go somewhere else. Do you remember, I don't know if they have them much anymore, but Toys R Us had those little vending machines for 25 or 50 cents, and it had little plastic capsules inside of them, and you would put in your coins and you turn it and you get a random capsule. And you'd pop that thing open, and you know, they had jewelry and stuff like that for girls. They had like slime and little dinosaurs and stuff for boys, and they had the most stale candy in the world if you happened to get one of those. And if you didn't like what you got, you know what you did? You put in another quarter or another two quarters, and you turned it again, and hopefully you got something better. Hopefully you got something better, because what you got, you didn't like. How easy it is that we move on. If it's a mistake when we move on from the Lord. If he says wait or he says no, trust that it's for a very good reason. Trust that it's for a very good reason. Don't miss out on God's blessing. Don't miss out on God's blessing because we couldn't trust and wait. We couldn't trust and wait. The last thing is that false gods are always dangerous. False gods are always dangerous. They promise so much, but they never deliver. They offer that they're going to give and give and give, but they always end up taking and taking more than you want. And the saddest thing is that not only in this life will they fail you, but in the day of judgment they will fail you. You see, all of us, men, women, boys, and girls, we will all stand before the Lord one day to either answer for our sin because we've died in our sin, or to get rewards and blessing from the Lord because our sin has been forgiven. You see, your wealth and your pleasurable conquests and your achievements and people's approval of you, they won't mean anything when the day comes of judgment. They won't save you from a moment of hell and pain and suffering. Hell is such a terrible place. People get this silly idea that it's a party nonstop, and they're just going to be there with all their friends. It's like where all the bad kids at school go and detention, and they turn it into some sort of get-together. It's a place of burning and at the same time darkness and torment. You and I can deal with pain because we know that there will be an end to it. When you get sick, you can push through it because you expect to get better. And when you break a bone in your body, you know that eventually it will stop hurting and it will heal and it will get better. And even if you live with chronic pain, you know that there will eventually be an end to it when this life is over. But the pain and the burning of hell has no end, and it's horrible. And just like Moses jumped in between the children of Israel and the wrath of God, the Lord Jesus Christ has jumped in between the wrath of God and us for our sin that we deserve. As that great intercessor, he went in between, and he couldn't just, with a simple word, tell God to stop being just or to stop being holy. You might as well ask the sun not to shine. Payment had to be made for sin. And God said, I love people, and I want them. And he loved the world so much that he gave his only begotten Son. That whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. You see, the Lord Jesus paid the debt that I owed, and he paid the debt that you owed. And none of my accomplishments and nothing that I've done for myself is going to get me one whit of a moment in heaven or save me from a single moment of the torments of hell. Only because the Lord Jesus did what he did and jumped in between God and me and said, I will go. And he came to this earth, and he became a man without ceasing to be God, and he lived that sinless life that the Lord required that you and I have never been able to live. And when it came time to die, it wasn't an accident or a tragedy. He laid down his life as a sacrifice. He said, a payment must be made, I will make it, and he paid it in his own blood. And praise God, he did not stay dead, but he was buried, and he rose from the grave on the third day, alive forevermore, proving that he was who he said he was and that he truly can give eternal life. Now there is a true way to heaven. Now the false gods can be set aside because there's a real place to find security in the Lord, a real place to find peace in the Lord, a real place to find meaning and value and joy and satisfaction. All of that is found in God Himself through the Lord Jesus Christ, our great intercessor who came in between us. Let go of your false gods and the pride that makes you cling to them. Let go and believe on the Lord, for that's where true deliverance is found. What are you not willing to give up to get heaven? Whose approval are you so worried about losing that you wouldn't grasp onto eternal life? False gods are always dangerous. Turn away from that sin and accept the Savior, because there is one who has jumped in between you and the wrath of God and said no, like Moses prayed for the people and for Aaron. And it came to pass as soon as he came nigh unto the camp that he saw the calf and the dancing. And Moses' anger waxed hot, and he cast the tables out of his hand and brake them beneath the mount. And he took the calf which they had made and burnt it in the fire and ground it to powder and strawed it upon the water and made the children of Israel to drink of it. Would you bow your heads with me and close your eyes for a moment? We have in our church what we call a time of invitation, where we invite you to act in your own heart and mind on what it is that God is speaking to you about. You know, that's what makes a good church service, is that God has spoken to you. He's gotten your attention about something, whether you like what he's put his finger on or whether you don't like what he's put his finger on. There have been many church services that I look back and say, that was a great church service, but I didn't feel great in the middle of it. No one likes having their sin called out. No one likes having their gods called false gods and revealed to be that. No one likes knowing that the things that they're trusting in aren't going to stand up in the day of judgment. But oh, do we need to hear it. No one likes to hear the diagnosis from the doctor that you have a serious terminal disease unless you receive treatment. But unless we hear it, we'll never seek the treatment. If you've never trusted Christ as Savior, I don't care if you're a good person, a bad person. I don't care if you belong to a church or don't belong to a church. I don't care if you've been baptized in every baptistry and river from the time you were born until this day. If you pay all your taxes and help little old ladies cross the street, if you give to every philanthropic organization, the question that will come down to when you stand before God is, what have you done with the Lord Jesus? Have you asked him to forgive your sins and be your Savior? This is the day of salvation. This is the moment to trust him. Stop fighting. You're fighting against your good. Can you imagine pushing the man out of the way who's trying to save you from that wrath of God and saying, no, I don't want it, just to have it condemn you to a life of torment that doesn't end? In just a moment, we'll stand and sing. I'll be down here in front. If you need to trust the Lord as Savior, today's the day to get that settled. While others are coming and praying, while other people are singing, you slip out of your seat and come and let me know and say, Pastor, I want to know for sure that my sins are forgiven. I want to know that heaven's my home. Someone will take a Bible, a gentleman with a gentleman, a lady with a lady, and speak with you privately how you can know for sure that your sins are forgiven. Maybe you're here today and you've never followed the Lord in believer's baptism since you've been saved. Maybe you want to put your life and influence in this church as a member. Or maybe, believer, you know the Lord, but something else has crept into the place of God. It started off being the true and living God, but now it's some lesser version that doesn't ask as much of you, that doesn't condemn anything that you do, that only congratulates you, and you see that that's not really God at all. Maybe you've allowed some of the way that the world does business to seep in, and you're now trusting in things other than the Lord. Come back to him, repent of him, turn from him. It's a dangerous road to walk on. The great news is that if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let's do business with the Lord this morning. Let's say yes to him. Father, I pray that you would be glorified by how we obey you in this time. In Jesus' name, amen.